meeting at the beginning when something irrelevant happens, then I forget to start. Thank you. So, what was that? Yeah. Whatever that is, if you don't take care of finances, then you have already seen 29% of the companies die because they don't manage their finance, they don't preempt their cash flow. If the cash flow is going to be negative after 6 months, if you can predict it now, you can always prevent. You can prevent failure. Number one. Number two, many people think that when they get money from investors, these are billions of dollars. Usually, entrepreneurs are first generation entrepreneurs. They have not seen millions of dollars in their account. The moment they see millions of dollars in their account, they think money is never ending. This money will never end. So they've become kind of it's called what is profligate or something. There is another word. Those who spurs money unwittingly. What is that called? It is opposite of thrifty, whatever that is. They are not thrifty enough. And eventually, they very soon realize that we actually did not have unending money, unlimited money. We had limited money. We would have started cutting corners, then we would have existed. I gave an example of AirWire, the drone company. They burned $118 million, and employees then told to them and to others, to the public, that this company would not have died if they were slightly thrifty, slightly reasonable in spending money. So, for all these, finance is necessary to understand, financial statement is necessary to understand the implication of every transaction on financial statements and profitability. So, this class will teach you how information gets merged into a profit loss account and into a balance sheet and into cash flow statement. Many students who join IIMs, they send me information that, sir, whatever you taught in maybe 2 weeks or so is a full subject at IIM, and they're not teaching anything extra, whatever you taught. I'm not bragging. I'm just trying to impress upon you to stay focused and learn whatever is there to learn, and learn completely, because many of you will be working in marketing, in manufacturing, and will never have an opportunity to learn finance. Now is the time. You will get almost see the end of it. Now, if you are an investor, if you become an investor, you'll have to learn something about investment, about what is earning per share, how what is book value, etc., etc. Those will not be covered. But if everybody becomes an investor, if you will start earning money like today, I think people who are earning salary to the extent of 1 lakh rupees or beyond, they are definitely investing something in stock market. Without knowing financial statements, you really, really cannot invest in anything. Not even, even if you want to invest in fixed deposit, you need some rational. You will not have that rational unless you are okay with financial statements. So you definitely know that companies are publishing financial statements. For all those companies who are listed in stock market, statutorily, they have to publish their profit loss account every quarter. Like the December quarter is over, now companies have started publishing their quarterly profit loss account. The first major company was Infosys, then TCS. No, TCS was first, then Infosis, then Wipro. And now many companies have come up with quarterly results. We are only at the middle of January, but quarterly results have started pouring in, and investors are keeping a close eye on those data. If the results are coming good, immediately share price is going up and investors' wealth is going up, not in thousands of rupees, in crores of rupees, or maybe lakhs of crores of rupees. Like TCS came up with good results, immediately the share price went up and investors reaped the benefit. They made something like lakhs of crores of rupees of wealth for themselves. So if you do not understand what these results are, how much is the increase of profit, and if you know it from surface only, it will not translate into something that can help you to make a decision. You have to really be conversant, and gradually you have to get deeper inside to understand what investors actually look for in a balance sheet, in a profit loss account, and in cash flow statement. Only then the information published in balance sheet makes sense. Otherwise, it will look like in news. Some news you will say that, you know, Tata Motors has increased the profit by 50%. You might think that, wow, that is wonderful, I should buy Tata Motors share. And you will buy the share, then only to realize that this 50% is with respect to the previous year. But compared to previous quarter, their profit has gone down. Then the share price will go down while you will be expecting it to go up. There are so many things to know before you think that you now have become an informed investor. So let us move forward fast. That much is the background. Second background is many students. I'm not bragging or, you know, trying to say some story. Many students told me during the class itself that with this introductory knowledge in finance, they could bag jobs. They could actually receive jobs with this introductory knowledge. Because during interview, there are many finance companies, investment companies. They start talking about balance sheet, and some students say, yes, if the profit is this, then this is like that, etc., etc. Then they become amazed that a BTech student knows about financial statements. That is wonderful. Then they ask question in financial statements. And if they can answer, they get a job without really going into the engineering. So that is why it will always help you if you really do this. Even in a, suppose you are not in a startup, you have not started a startup, you are in a regular company, and there is a meeting, whether it's a board meeting or a departmental meeting or whatever meeting. Now, during the meeting, you will be attending all the meetings because these are all online, so number of audience will be always more. Now, the director will be there and you will be listening to the meeting. Director will say, we are going to do this. Or some marketing man is going to say, you know, we have to reduce the price, otherwise we won't be able to sell because competitors have reduced the price. Now, suppose you are on the other end of the meeting. Now, you say that, okay, you want to reduce the price, but we cannot reduce the cost of production because our input cost is not going down. So immediately, director will note that you understand that price cannot go down just like that. Price can go down only if input cost goes down. So visibility can be obtained. You can contribute to the company if you are familiar with the financial statements. So everywhere, you will be a knowledgeable person and you will be able to contribute meaningfully if you have knowledge on financial statements. Let's move forward. So there are three financial statements. One is profit and loss account, another is balance sheet, and third is cash flow statement. I'll be talking about all of them. We'll visit the entire value chain or whatever you call them. And then there is a fourth statement. Some people call it a fourth statement, some people don't care about it. That is the statement of equity, owner's equity, meaning if you are investing in a company, say your company or somebody else's company, you become an owner. So this ownership is maintained in a separate account that is called account statement of owner's equity or owner's capital. Now, these are all introductory. They are saying if you cannot manage finance, you cannot manage business. And you have seen already 29% companies die because they fail on cash flow. All entrepreneurs, non-entrepreneurs who are directly, remotely connected to the past, present, or future, they have to know all of that. And if you, whatever, organized company, established company, or startup, there are many people who are interested in your financial statements. Founders themselves are interested, shareholders are interested, lenders. If bank is giving you money, bank will always chase you that give us the financial statements. Where is the latest financial statements? Because banks also would like to know where do you stand today? Is your profit going up or going down? Should the bank be concerned about your future health? So lenders, government, because government is interested to earn income tax. They want to see how much profit you have made. Have you paid income tax commensurate with your profit? And then there is GST. Economists are interested because they want to forecast the GDP. So they want to know what is the GDP today. GDP is the total, sum total of the output of all the industries and other things, government. Analysts are interested because they want to publish a report that, yes, this company is doing good, bad or ugly. So investors should be, you know, remain investors, employees, policymakers and a statistician. These all people are interested about your financial statements. So wherever you work, you can very well understand that you are interested in financial statements. Now, if you do not understand what they are, how are you going to use them? Okay, so financial statements, every financial statements has two sides. One is those who are preparing it, those who are direct beneficiary of this information. And the other side, who consume the information and make decisions. So if you are a startup or if you are a company owner, you want to show more profit. So you have an objective to show profit, higher profit. On the other side, there are investors who look at this information and then make decisions. If you give some cooked up data, they will depend on that cooked up data and make investment, then they will incur loss. Because cooked up data cannot be sustained for a long time. You cannot cook up data for a long, long time. We have seen that happening in Satyam Computer, and then for 4 or 5 years it continued and suddenly it collapsed because it could not continue for such a long time. And eventually even Pricewaterhouse was penalized for not being able to identify that there are so much of manipulation in that balance sheet. So from Satyam Computer, from America, there were so many scams, and then the stock market crashed for that. I think that, what is the power company? Whatever, it's very difficult actually. At the time of lecture, I normally forget all those right names. It's coming to my mind, but it's not coming. Whatever. So, from that story, one thing you should know is that accounts can be manipulated to a large extent. If you look at balance sheet that is published in the marketplace, in the newspaper and other places, you should be mindful that this data may not be accurate, because data are published by companies with an objective to transmit this data to the investors or other stakeholders. So there will always be a motivation to fuzz the account and give the right information, not the correct information. Give the right information, not the correct information. Right information is what? That will romance the investor. That will give a nicer picture to the lenders. Bank will think that, wow, this company is making wonderful profit, so let us give them more money because our money is safe. Whereas this company perhaps manipulated, perhaps this is not the accurate data. So correct data and right data are very different here. So you should be very, means this happens randomly. This happens randomly, not just once, twice or thrice, not just in 10% of the companies. It happens with almost 100% of the company, almost. There are some, like say, I will count Tata's to be on the right side, maybe ITC, maybe Hindustan Lever, some of the highly professional companies which are managed by professionals. Even Pricewater is supposed to be one of the most ethical companies, but they are found to be unethical on many, many counts, not just once or twice. HSBC is supposed to be the wonderful bank and should be a kind of a benchmark, but they do all kinds of heraferies. They have been caught to do all kinds of heraferies, and countries look upon them as wealth destroyer rather than wealth creator, and promoting fraud rather than preventing fraud. So you should be careful, number one. Number two, in this world of computer, in this world of information empowerment, why this is happening, how this is happening, why we are not able to prevent them. Because there is a need for preventing. Why there is a need? You know, the number of transactions that happens or amount of transactions that happen in stock market are more than the aggregate GDP of the world. That is the size. The size is humongous. And these transactions are happening based on the information that is published by companies. So all those transactions becomes or are done based on frivolous information. Because these informations are manipulated, as I said. But then we really cannot prevent this manipulation. Because there's always a way to work around and provide false information even after meticulously obeying the rules and regulations that are supposed to be followed. So chartered accountants are there to do that. Because you tell the chartered accountants that this year was not good. We incurred loss, small amount of loss. How much? Maybe 5 crore. Now you're going to tell the chartered accountant that don't show loss. Then my share price will go down. Show at least 25 crore rupees of profit. We'll show 25 crore rupees of profit after meticulously remaining within the boundary of rules and regulation. It is so much possible. And that is why there are international accounting body called International Accounting Standards Organization, IAAS, perhaps. You can Google search. Maybe I have a slide on that. They come up, they are always doing research. What kind of fraud is happening in corporate world and how to catch them? That is their job. Every now and then, almost every day, they are coming out with new findings and they are asking countries to adopt new measures to prevent those frauds. Every now and then. That is their job. They are global bodies. There are two bodies, IFS, perhaps, International Standard for Financial Account, IFS, ISFA. They look after American accounting standard called, what is that? I'll tell you later. Now, okay, this is very different. Let us move forward. This we have discussed. Sorry. Yeah, Enron is the name I was trying to refer. Enron is a power manufacturing company, power producing company. They showed profit when they were not making profit. They had 22,000 employees. They started a manufacturing plant in Bombay also, investing tens of thousands of crores of rupees. They reported $111 billion of revenue in 2000. Overstated profit, high debt. When it came to light, share price went down from $90 a piece to 67 cents a piece. That was in 2002. 2000, share price was $90. Then it went down to 0.67. After a year, it went down to zero. There was no value at all. So those people who invested in this company based on the published balance sheet, and they were sitting pretty thinking that this company is making huge profit. So $90 share price will become $1,000. Let me sit tight. They sat back with junk papers that has no value, zero value. That is why accounting has so important. Like WorldCom also, same story. You just read them. I'll not. Satyam Computer. Yeah, this is very important. Let me just come out of the introductory part. For any company, there is an accounting cycle or operating cycle. It starts from cash. I was giving an example of a plastic pen. Suppose suppose you want to manufacture plastic pen. The investment that you need for manufacturing plastic pen is very meager, not much. You need a, what kind of a machine? A pressure molding machine. There are plastic granules available in the marketplace. You buy those granules. Then there is something called a mold. You put a mold in a pressing machine, pour the plastic granules inside that, then with your hand itself you can press, and the cap will come out, the other part will come out, somebody will join them together, you have a pen. So if you have 100 such machines, you are going to manufacture 100 pens per, maybe say per 5 seconds. Within 5 seconds you have 100 pens. That means in a year you are going to have so many pens. I have to catch this guy who is creating them. Dibyang Mittal. Dibyang Mittal. Mute yourself. You have a whole team at the background.
Sir, then, you can mute himself.
Yeah, but then if you mute everybody, then...
No, not all, sir. You can mute Dibyang Mittal only. Like only organizers can mute, we can't.
Yeah, I have done it. Okay, thank you. Thank you, that's good. I should know, means gradually I'm knowing. At least now there is no problem of muting the students by others. Okay, so suppose you're manufacturing plastic pens. So now why do you get the plastic? You get the plastic in the marketplace. When you go to buy the plastic from the marketplace, they'll say, give me the money, give me cash. Then only I'll give you plastic. So you bring those plastic material by paying cash. So you start the business with cash. Even buying the machine also starts with cash, but machine is not in this picture. So you go to market with cash, buy raw material like plastic granules, come to your factory. Then you make finished goods like pen. So pens are prepared. Now, pen will not get converted into cash. You get the pen, then you sell it in the marketplace, you take it to wholesale marketplace. People buy hundreds of pens at a time, not hundreds, thousands and lakhs. So before that, when you manufacture, suppose today you manufacture 1,000 pens. You are not going to go to market with 1,000 pens. You will deposit that in a godown. You will put that in a godown. That is called finished goods stockyard. So you will be putting all the pens in finished goods stock, stockyard, whatever that is. That may be a single room, rented room, or that may be a full-fledged warehouse, depending on how big is the company. So you are putting finished goods, finished pens there. That is another step. Then you are going to sell it to the marketplace. Your vendors will come, wholesaler will come, or maybe distributors, they'll come, or maybe you will be shipping it to the distributors. Now those distributors will take those pens, but they will not pay you cash. They will say, I'm taking it today, I'll send the check. Or maybe they'll give a check which is post-dated. They'll say that after 15 days, you get it encashed. So after 15 days only, that money, that check will be converted into cash. It is not just the check, it is actually the finished goods are getting converted into cash after 15 days, or sometimes it is 1 month, sometimes it becomes 6 months, depending on what is the terms of payment with the wholesaler or distributor. So after 15 days, or maybe as long as it remains as check or bills receivable, it remains as account receivable. We'll discuss that later, but know that finished goods go to vendors go down, whatever you have is accounts receivable. That is some document that remains with you. We'll discuss that later. Then after some time, maybe 15 days, 1 month or 6 months, money comes to your bank account. So you collect the money, it becomes cash. That is the cycle. You start with cash, go to market, buy plastic, then bring that plastic in the shop floor, you make pens. After making the pens, you put it in the godown, that becomes finished goods. From finished goods, you sell it to the customers, that may be a wholesaler or whatever. So as long as it goes to the wholesaler and payment doesn't come, it remains as accounts receivable. From accounts receivable, you send the check for collection, then it comes to the bank. When it comes to the bank after collection, it becomes cash. This And time required for this cycle is quite large. And this time is known as period for operating cycle. How big is your operating cycle? Now, the same thing has been shown in a graphical way. So you are here, you start buying raw material, then it becomes goods in process, meaning the raw material is kept on the shop floor. So it remains, and some people bring those plastic, they start converting them into paint caps and other components, then other people assemble them. So it remains goods in process. Then it goes to finished goods stock, then it goes to dealer, it becomes receivables, then it goes to the customer. Sometimes you directly sell to customers, sometimes you go through dealer. Like suppose you have a website and customers may buy directly, whatever that is, eventually it comes to your bank, then it becomes cash. So that is how the whole scenario. I have some example of Adani's. I'll talk about it when I discuss about balance sheet, because now I have already wasted a lot of time. I don't want to discuss them now, but I'll take some bit of diversion. So suppose, think of this pen manufacturing company. Now you need some machine for manufacturing this pen, some pressure molding machine. Suppose that requires 10,000 rupees. That is your investment in fixed asset. This machine will remain with you for a long, long time. Not just one day, 2 days, 1 month, 2 months. As long as the company is there, unless the machine is becoming defunct or something, machine is going kaput, machine will remain with you. That is why these are called fixed asset, long-term asset, long-term asset. Whereas when you go to market, buy plastic granules to convert them into pen, this remains in your godown for a little while, maybe for a month, maybe for a day, maybe for at the most 1 year, not beyond 1 year, normally. That is our experience. So that is why these are called current asset or short-term asset. Current asset or short-term asset. Other is fixed asset or long-term asset, non-current asset, etc. There are many names. So raw material is current asset because it remains, currently it remains with you. Normally asset which remains with the company for a period of less than a year is termed as current asset. So raw material is less than a year, so it is current asset. Remember, any material that remains with the company for a period which is shorter than a year, those are current assets. Then there is goods in process, meaning you have converted plastic granules into pen cap. But the pen cap is yet to be fixed with a clip, and then fix the pen and then put it in a packaging, etc., etc. These are happening. So all those goods also is holding money. You understand? Suppose you have one bag full of plastic granules. It is not free. It has come with some money. Suppose you have paid 1,000 rupees to the seller. So this one bag full of plastic granules is 1,000 rupees equivalent. Maybe you paid him only 600 rupees and you told him that I will pay the remaining 400 rupees later. So that becomes current account payable. You have to pay them later. So that becomes account payable. And when you sell to somebody, that somebody tells you, I am paying you only partially, I'll pay the rest later, that becomes accounts receivable. Accounts payable, accounts receivable. So now, goods in pay process is 500 rupees worth of goods lying in the shop floor. Finished goods, meaning the pens that you have already manufactured, they are in the packages, etc., etc., they're ready for dispatch. So those are called finished goods. Suppose at any point of time, on an average, you maintain about 2000 rupees worth of finished goods. So finished goods is consuming 2000 rupees. Of money, of capital. Now suppose any point of time you are supposed to receive 2500 rupees from the people who bought your goods. It's a continuous process. Every now and then some company will come, company truck will come, they will carry your goods and then a bill will be raised. So you are kind, it's a kind of a continuous process going on up and down. Okay. So everything to then as a receivable act. Receivable meaning you're supposed to get the money. Now, raw material stock is 100 1000, all these money has to be there somewhere, otherwise you won't be able to run the business, because you have to have money to buy raw material, then the finished goods, then receivables also, meaning some goods were prepared and then sold. So those money has to be there. Money cannot come from anywhere. So total requirement of money for running the operating cycle is 6,000 rupees. How? 1,500, 2,000, 2,500. And you needed 10,000 rupees to buy the manufacturing machine. So that is another 10,000, totally 16,000. This is the project cost. If somebody approaches you that, can you make a project cost for me or project report for me? You have to ask him, what is the total investment requirement? Can you tell me? What is the operating cycle? Can you tell me how much money you need? So total is your fixed asset requirement is worth 10,000 rupees, and your working capital or running cost or current assets and all that is worth 6,000 rupees. So total asset or total requirement of money, that is liabilities, is 16,000 rupees. So if you have 16,000 rupees, you can start this plastic pen manufacturing company. Get this? If you have any doubt, you can raise your hand. Somebody has unmuted. You want to ask something? Okay, forget it. Don't worry. Let me move forward. You know, we have a long way to go. Long, long way to go. I wanted to cover at least 60-70 slides. At 11th slide now, but this slide I'll explain later. It's very important, but we'll explain it later. So when you, these are some funny things, when you buy raw material, it comes to your godown and cash has to go out. So this is called double entry system. Just to show you, whenever you make any transaction, the first transaction that you make, suppose, is buying raw material. You want to convert that into finished goods. Then gradually many other things happen. So when you buy raw material, the raw material stock goes up. So this is a book. This is a khata where you write the amount of raw material that you are maintaining or buying or selling, whatever. So when goods come, your raw material ledger goes up, meaning suppose it is 1000 rupees or say 700 rupees, is it 700, 500 rupees of purchase. So raw material goes up by 500. You pay 300 rupees of cash to the guy. So your cash ledger is called ledger. Every book is a ledger. Your cash ledger goes down by 300 rupees because 300 rupees goes out from the company and goes to the person who has supplied the raw material. So what happens to the remaining 200? That remains as accounts payable. You have to pay somebody 200 rupees later. So that somebody's account, in your accounts payable account, will go up by 200 rupees. It goes to that guy who supplied the raw material. Okay. Now, so this is debit credit rule. I'll tell you, this is not so very important. But if somebody can afford to put some pressure on the memory, then it is good to remember. You don't have to remember this for examination. I'll not put a question as to if this happens, whether it should be debited or credited. But it is wise to remember. Let me tell you, I'm giving a very shortcut formula and it is very easy to remember. I said that there are ledgers, which are books. So suppose you have started this plastic pen manufacturing company. What is the first thing that you did about money? You have brought in some money of your own to the company. That is called equity capital. Whatever money you have brought in, that is called equity capital. I told you that total money required to start and run a plastic pen manufacturing company is 16,000 rupees. 16,000 rupees. Now, suppose you want to start that business, but you do not have 16,000 rupees in your bank. How much you have? You check your account, you tell your dad, you ask every Tom, Dick, Harry, and they gave you money. Total 10,000 rupees. So 10,000 rupees is your money. From where you got, that is a different issue. They have given to you, not to the business. Remember, business is one entity, you are another entity. Business is one entity, you are another entity. Even though you own the business, business will have a separate account, you will have a separate account. Now suppose you could gather or arrange 10,000 rupees. That is the equity capital. Now you need another 6,000 rupees. Without that, you cannot run the business. Without arranging the whole money, it is never advisable to start the business. So you approach to bank that give me 6,000 rupees. I want to start this business. I'll return the money after this, that. Then bank will tell you, okay, we'll give, provided your dad gives a guarantee that if you do not repay, if you fail to repay, then dad will pay. This is called security, collateral security. Meaning, if you give any security other than the asset that you create out of the loan, it is called collateral. Collateral. Suppose you mortgage your house property, that if I cannot repay the money, you can sell my house. Give me 6,000 rupees. They'll be more than glad to give you 6,000 rupees of loan. So you have equity capital of 10,000 and you have borrowed money of 6,000 rupees. So the first transaction is you have brought in 10,000 rupees. Now when you bring in 10,000 rupees, it is cash. So cash actually is an asset. Cash is an asset. Now know that when cash goes up, the ledger is debited. Final. Full stop. When any asset that goes up, the respective asset ledger is debited. So you have a ledger by the name cash. Now when you brought in 10,000 rupees, cash ledger is debited by 10,000 and it is shown that 10,000 rupees has been brought in by so and so. Okay, that is the cash ledger first transaction. What is the contra transaction? I said double entry means for every transaction, there will be two entries, at least two entries, two or more. Here, cash is one entry. You have brought in the money in terms of equity capital. Equity capital is a liability. Why is a liability? I'll tell you later, but equity capital is a liability. When liability goes up, it is credited. So because you have brought in 10,000 rupees, equity capital went up, so it is credited. So there will be a khata or account or ledger by the name equity capital. In that, you will write increase in equity capital of 10,000 rupees, so it is credited. Because any liability going up is credited, any asset going up is debited, and always debit credit are equal. So that is how, suppose you buy something, say you buy 500 rupees of raw material. So raw material is classified as asset. Asset goes up by 500 rupees, that is one entry. Your asset ledger goes up by 500, that is one entry. But now, for that, you pay 300 rupees of cash to the supplier. So cash ledger goes down because cash, you take that cash and give it to somebody else. So ledger goes down. When asset goes down, it is credited. So cash ledger is credited. Accounts payable is a liability. When liability goes up, it is credited. Asset going up is debited, liability going up is credited. So you credit both cash account and accounts payable account, and you debit purchase account. The account is balanced, so this is how double entry happens. Here there are three transactions in this double entry system. Because I am not keeping that for examination, I am not spending so much of time. Three major financial statements I have already said. Okay. So we have something like officially 7 minutes, but if I go up to 1 o'clock, then it is 12 minutes. I'm shouting too much. I'm kind of running out of energy. Okay, so balance sheet, profit loss account, cash flow statement. Let us start with balance sheet. Now, I said, or I perhaps did not say. See, financial statements contain information. Financial statements contain information about the financials of your company. Out of that, balance sheet contains information about your assets and liabilities. What are the fixed assets? What are the current assets? Those are the assets. And how you have funded it are the liabilities. Why it is liabilities? Because these are sources of money. Balance sheet can be viewed or perceived as two sides of the company. One side is the sources of money, which are liabilities. The other side is the application of money or utilization of money, which is asset side. Why this is asset and why that is liability? Because the liability sides are the sources of money. Sources means what? Where from money has come. Why that is liability? Because money comes from bank, money comes from lenders, money comes from all entities external to the company. All the entities external to the company. Like even founder is external because founder and company are two different identities. Okay. So, all the sources of money, all the sources are liabilities. And when you get money, you invest somewhere. Whether you buy raw material or you buy machinery, you are actually investing the money in something. That is why they are all asset. You create asset by paying money. That is why the utilization of money is asset. So that is why one side is asset, another side is liability. Now, at any point of time, you look at the company and in your mental image, you try to take a snapshot, a photo of the company. Whatever you see, that is the balance sheet. Suppose you see a lot of machinery, you see some stock, you see some receivables, you see some payables, you see some whatever. You see they are part of the balance sheet. Any snapshot at any point of time represent the balance sheet of the company because it gives you idea about the current assets and current liabilities. Current means present assets and present liabilities, both current and fixed. Okay. So that is what is balance sheet. And that is why balance sheet can refer to any point of time. It may be balance sheet as on 31st March 2021. That may be a balance sheet. It may be balance sheet as on 20th of January 2021. Whenever you prepare information about the present state of assets and liabilities, that becomes a balance sheet. That is why balance sheet refers to a particular date. Refers to a particular date.
So,
on the flip side, profit loss account refers to a particular period. Meaning, during a certain period, how much you sold, how much profit you made, that is the profit and loss account. You don't make a sale momentarily. You make a sale over a period of time. Like for a quarter, for a month, for a day, for a week, for anything, for a year. So for a certain period, you make some sales. Out of the sales, you make some profit. That is why profit loss account statement refers to certain period. Like 1st of April to 2020 to 31st of March 2021, something like that. So it refers to a certain period. Balance sheet refers to a certain date, as on particular date. By the way, was there a question? I forgot, means I failed to notice. Was there a question? Was there?
Yes, sir.
Go ahead.
Sir, I'm a bit confused between liability and spending an asset. How are they both different?
Okay. You said how? Yeah, come again.
So, spending an asset and liability, how are they both different from each other?
Okay, the question itself is to be paraphrased. See, you don't invest money in liabilities. Understand liability not from the investment perspective point of view. Understand liability as a source. Liabilities are always a source of money. So you don't invest money, you get money through liabilities. You get money through liability. Look at any entry in the balance sheet through the liability side. Whatever are mentioned on the liability side, they are only sources of money. They are not application of money. Get this point? Now you ask the question again. How do you differentiate liabilities and?
Like assets are also the source of money that we are investing.
No. Let me clarify. Okay. Assets are not sources of money. See, what are their assets? Suppose you are this plastic manufacturing company. You try to look into the premises, you will see that there is a machine, there is a rack where raw materials are kept, or maybe tools are kept. Then there is this building within which you are doing this business. Then there are some tools and equipments for maintenance. There is this raw material kept at some corner. There is this semi-finished goods, which is called goods in process. There are some finished goods lying in another corner. Everything, these are all assets. And in every asset, you have invested money. This asset will become money only when you sell them. Before you sell, it remains within the factory. Once you sell, it goes to the customer's godown. Only then it gets translated into money. Otherwise, these consume money. They don't give money. No asset gives you money. Okay? Whereas liability is something like bank loan is a liability. If the bank loan goes up, money comes in. Get this? If suppose liability is accounts payable, meaning somebody is giving you raw material on credit. So that person is a liability, or that transaction is a liability, because you have to pay money someday. Wherever you are getting some benefit and you have to pay money someday, they're all liabilities. Okay, it'll be more clear as we move forward. Don't worry. Take care. Let me just, we have few more minutes. Let me see if we can. Okay, these are about cash flow statement. Just let me introduce the cash flow statement, then we'll call it a day. Cash flow statements are the different sources of cash, not money alone. Cash. Suppose you are getting some raw material on credit. It's not cash, but cash equivalent. So all the cash that are coming in, all the cash that are going out, both in the form of cash or in the form of cash equivalent. Cash equivalent means it will be converted into cash. Very soon you're going to convert this asset into cash. That is called cash equivalent. So there are three types of cash, type cash flow. One is operational activities. That means you are selling goods, you're getting cash. That is operating activities. Investment activities, like you are paying cash for buying some machinery. Suppose today you buy a maybe telephone, so cash goes out. That is investment, because this asset will remain with you for a long time. That is why it is an investment. Financing activities, like suppose you raise some new loan, or founders brings in new money. These are all financing activities. So money comes or goes through three different activities. One is operational activities, another is investment activities, third is financing activities. Okay, so through these three streams money comes in. So you should remember this, that money cash flow happens through operational activities, through investment activities, and through financing activities, meaning how you finance your businesses. Oh, sorry.
Can you tell again operational activities? What's that?
Yeah, operational is the first part. Operating or operational. Operating
Yes,
or
sir.
operational. Normally they call operational activity, maybe it's maybe a typo, but operating is okay. Investment activities and financing activities. And if you prepare profit loss account
I'm
statement,
asking the
people
definition, sir, for
will.
operational activities.
Oh, what is the definition of operational? Like suppose you prepare a profit loss account, then at the end, you will end up with some profit. So that is the money coming out of operational activities. Meaning you are doing the entire operation like manufacturing, then selling. After everything, you realize the money. So you deduct all the expenses out of the sales. Then whatever money remains, that is the cash flow from operating activities. There will be some more operating activities like depreciation is another part of operating activities. We'll see that in detail. Okay. See that in detail. But know that this cash flow, at the end of the cash flow statement, you understand whether the company is cash positive or cash negative. Meaning that during the last year, previous year, has the company lost so much cash that cash balance become negative? If that is the case, then company goes bankrupt. You cannot really sustain. And if you can predict that before 6 months, 6 months before it happens, then you can avert this situation. Yes, there is another question. What is that? Astitva, want to ask something? Is it in question? Okay, let me not move forward. As I promised that I will not overstep. So let me not overstep. I have already taken the attendance. I have to just stop recording.